In 1971, the UC Berkeley professor Leon Chua published a paper proposing a new circuit which he called the Memristor. At the time, it was a strange proposal, steeped in theory, and most people forgot about it. Over 30 years later, with the AI revolution in full swing, scientists are exploring how to use these memristors and their unique conductive properties in analog AI accelerators. In this video, an introduction into these strange and controversial circuits, as well as their potential in the world of AI. Chua's 1971 paper began by laying out some interesting connections between the three fundamental two-terminal circuit elements. Two-terminal, meaning that there are two connections, the current flowing through from one connection to the other. By comparison, the transistor is a three-terminal device. These three elements were also passive, meaning that they did not use energy. This is again in contrast to the transistor, which requires a voltage to work. Anyway, these three passive elements were the resistor, capacitor, and inductor. And you can describe their behaviors using relationships between two of four electrical variables: voltage, current, charge, and magnetic flux. The capacitor was first invented in 1745 when two scientists produced the Leyden jar. A capacitor stores and discharges electrical energy. Thus, it relates charge and voltage. The resistor can be said to have been invented in 1827 when George Simon Ohm laid out Ohm's law, which relates voltage and current. The resistor limits or regulates the flow of an electrical current in a circuit. Then we have the inductor. In 1831, Michael Faraday discovered electromagnetic induction. In his experiment, he wrapped a paper tube in wire, attached a galvanometer to the wire's ends, and moved a magnet in and out of the tube. The inductor stores electrical energy in a magnetic field when a current is passed through it. Thus, it relates current and changes in the magnetic field, called flux linkage. This relationship is described by Faraday's law of induction. Through it, we can also draw a relationship between voltage and flux linkage. Upon drawing out these relationships between the three circuit elements and the electrical variables, Chua felt that there was a missing piece, a fourth element that should connect magnetic flux linkage and charge. Thus, Chua proposed a memory resistor, or memristor, to fill the gap. His student Sung Mo's Steve Kang later wrote a second paper clarifying the concept. The memristor is a resistive device with inherent memory. Chua and Kang's equations are to help us predict its behavior. The memristor is similar to the resistor, but how resistive the memristor is at a given point of time depends on the history of electrical current and voltage passing through it. This history is unique, which is what differentiates the memristor from the aforementioned resistor. A resistor's resistive value is fixed all the time. A memristor's value, the relationship between its inputs and outputs, changes over time in a non-linear way based on some internal value. Double the input, don't get double the output. Ergo, the memristor is called a non-linear electronic component device. Electrical engineers like to use water metaphors to describe their work. Imagine a pipe with a flow of river water passing through it. The flow of water is the current. The voltage is the pressure compelling the water to flow. The pipe facilitates the flow of water, kind of like how a conductor conducts a current through it. You can think of the memristor as being something like a sand filter inside that pipe. It is a device that impedes the flow of water, but selectively and in a way that changes over time. The more river water flows through the filter, passing around the sand grains, the more debris and detritus from the river gets stuck in between those grains. No, it does not store water. That's a bucket, or a capacitor if we extend out the metaphor. By definition, a bucket remembers how much water it has, because the water is in it. On the other hand, our memristor pipe remembers how much water has passed through it without actually storing it. Are we really sure that the memristor is a fundamental circuit? A few people pointed out that the memristor and the resistor are quite similar. Both are about resistance values. It's just that the memristor has a non-linear output. Does that really make it fundamental? Nevertheless, Chua published the idea as a curiosity amongst other more significant mathematical work done in nonlinear circuits, and since no actual memristor existed, people appreciated it as a nice piece of theory. Then in the 2000s, researchers at Hewlett-Packard were playing around with oxide materials and the physics of resistive switching. Resistive switching is a known phenomenon when a material abruptly changes its resistance value when exposed to an electric field. So HP had invented this two-terminal, two-layer semiconductor made from two platinum electrodes separated by a thin film of titanium dioxide. Titanium dioxide is widely used as a critical ingredient in white paint and also sunscreen. Normally, it is a very high resistor. But if while depositing a layer of titanium dioxide you withhold some oxygen, then the resulting layer's crystal lattice has a region with some oxygen vacancies. We say that this region of titanium dioxide is doped. Usually you might think doping means to add something, but if you think about it, we are adding vacancies. So it works. Roll with me here. When you apply voltage, then a current starts to pass through this titanium dioxide. But in doing so, this current must pass through two regions, one that is undoped and is a good resistor, as well as a doped layer with less resistance. The device's final resistive value is an agglomeration of the resistances of the doped and undoped regions. The boundary line between these two regions can drift, causing the memristor to change its final resistive value depending on how much current passed through it. So the HP team saw these very strange relationships and went into the literature. They came across Chua's memristor papers and realized that his equations broadly, though not precisely, fit the boundary's drift behavior. Thusly, in 2008, the HP team and R. Stanley Williams announced that they had an implementation of the memristor. The announcement has generated some mixed feelings. Devices are invented all the time. The issue is that we want one that matches the equations, an ideal. Critics argued that the HP memristor does not match Chua's equations. Thusly, the ideal memristor had not actually been invented in 2008 and might in fact be unachievable. One of the louder critics was Blaise Motet, an ex-US patent officer. He called HP's claims of the memristor's invention as a, quote, propaganda campaign by HP to take credit for emerging memory devices invented by other companies, end quote. He also added that in 1960, Bernard Widrow coined the term memistor, or memory resistor. It is a three-terminal device that also has memory and exhibits resistance value. Widrow created a physical implementation of the memistor, though it does not look anything like a chip. First, there is a two-terminal wire immersed in a bath of chemicals. You can send a current through the bath. If you apply an electric current to the bath through the third terminal, then metals can form on the pathway via electroplating, affecting the resistant wire's resistance. The memristor and memristor are pretty similar, but there are two critical differences. First, there are three terminals rather than two. And second, it was not a solid-state device, which was a prerequisite for the device to ever become useful and scalable in semiconductor production. So despite being used for some neural network research in the 1960s, it ended up largely being forgotten. There are other examples even further back in the history. For instance, one claim of memristors accidentally being invented in a carbon arc lamp discharge experiment back in 1801. For what it is worth, Chua has declared the 2008 HP semiconductor to indeed be a memristor, but he changed his previous definition to do so, calling all memory devices based on resistive switching memristors, regardless of the relationships between charge and magnetic flux and all that. There have been a number of different proposed memristors. They mostly share a similar structure to the HP 2008 titanium dioxide memristor, a metal insulator metal, or MIM sandwich. Like with edible sandwiches, the ingredients have a major effect on the MIM's performance. Commonly used metals include inert metals like copper, platinum, tungsten, silver, and gold, but more exotic things like titanium nitride ceramics or even carbon nanotubes have also been tried. The metals are important and can participate in the resistive behavior. However, the most important part of the sandwich is the insulator sitting in the middle. There are two types of insulators, organic and inorganic. The former are cheaper to use, prepare, and can be very flexible, as in we can fold them like with OLEDs. Inorganic material, on the other hand, tend to give you better resistive switching behaviors and can be compatible with traditional semiconductor manufacturing processes, a big bonus. It is all a balance. Memristors have many interesting applications to computation, but we're here to talk about AI, so let us talk about how we can use these to do neural network calculations as a compute and memory solution. This is done by first connecting together these bad boys in a crossbar pattern, essentially rows of MIM memristor sandwiches wired together in two ways. At the top, each sandwich is connected to a bar of metal running horizontally, left to right. On the bottom of the sandwich, the memristors are connected to another bar of metal, this time running up and down vertically. When we want to read the data value of one memristor, we run a sensing voltage, specifically tuned for measuring things, through the top wire. That voltage travels into the memristor and then through it into the bottom wire, which we can measure in order to get the memristor's resistance value. Writing a data value is done similarly. Each memristor has a threshold. You activate the top and bottom wires, each one at half that threshold. Only the target memristor, the one that touches both top and bottom wires, receives a voltage high enough to cause it to change. Once the memristors are programmed with their unique resistive values, we can use them to run the AI calculations. When we run inference on a model, what the hardware is doing is performing many vector matrix multiplication operations. The model is made up of parameters, numbers that we obtain through training. We take those parameters as well as the numbers from our data input and then multiply and sum together many, many times over. A memristor crossbar can perform these using what is called analog computations. Analog is a different paradigm than digital. It involves continuous values modeled on the real world rather than the abrupt ones and zeros from the digital world. The memristor crossbar lets us use fundamental laws in electrical engineering to do multiplication and summation across a whole row of memristors. Each memristor in the row has its own special resistive value, representing model parameters. If we apply voltage across the top row, then that signal interacts with each of the memristors' unique resistance values to create a current. If you recall, the voltage is like pressure, and it causes water, which is like current, to flow. That current is a unique value produced by the voltage multiplied by the memristor's conductance, which is the inverse of its resistance value. Higher conductance, higher current for the same voltage. We then read out all the currents in the whole row as a single value. The result is the literal physical manifestation of the result of our multiply add action. Because we perform all the matrix multiplication calculations right inside the memory cells where the parameters are stored, we call this compute in memory. It skips right over the power and latency issues associated with the von Neumann bottleneck. We do a whole round of vector matrix multiplication operations in a single low power step. We save a lot of time and energy against existing digital AI accelerators. The difference can be formidable, especially at larger sizes. If your numbers, the matrix, fit into the crossbar, then the calculations will be done in the same amount of time, a concept referred to as constant time. These crossbars likely work best for inference, the times when you're actually running the model in the real world. Training a larger commercial-class neural model requires more precision than what modern analog systems can provide and are compute-intensive. So right now, it makes more sense to train the model the usual way and then transfer it into the memristor crossbar. Memristors are CMOS compatible. This means that we can make these memristors on top of silicon wafers using traditional semiconductor manufacturing techniques, deposition, photolithography, etch, the works. This opens up the possibility of CMOS memristor hybrids. One example from a March 2023 Nature article had the CMOS part stabilizing the various levels of readable resistance in the chips. The authors note that these would be more suitable for edge solutions. CMOS compatibility offers a few major benefits. First, we can make the memristors very small, with layers each about 10 nanometers thick. We can even stack them in a 3D manner. This means more memory capacity for potentially better models. Second, we get to drift in the wake of the massive investments made by the larger semiconductor industry. We can tap the existing ecosystem to quickly scale up production of an advanced product. The big catch, however, is defectivity. Normal defects in the manufacturing process can cause the memristor to work below its expectations or break down, especially after just a few cycles. And since analog calculators so fundamentally depend on their physical interactions to do their work, defects matter doubly more here than with digital systems. New metrology and test tools will need to be developed in order to detect and fix these issues throughout and after production. Memristors don't have a monopoly on analog computation for neural networks. There are many more implementations. For instance, IBM recently published an analog AI chip based on similar analog computational principles. This one, however, uses a different type of non-volatile memory, called phase change memory, which relies on phase changes in a material induced by heat. And in a previous video, I covered another analog AI accelerator that used the interactions of light to perform neural network calculations. I do think memristor-based systems have some potential, especially considering how they can tap the existing CMOS ecosystem like MEMS do, though I do wonder if there is the 10x leap forward in performance that paradigm-shifting technologies need to have in order to overcome their limitations. But the market is there. I hope to someday see some memristor-based accelerators hitting the market in the near future. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. I'll see you guys next time.